everybody. You're all very welcome to the last event of term for the Conspiracy, Democracy and Research Group. If you haven't come before, we're a Leverhulme-funded, five-year Leverhulme-funded project. We're based in Crash, money. We're coming to the end of our second year. It's a project which has three PIs, principal investigators, Professors Richard Evans and David Huntsman and John Moulton is here. And then a number of postdoctoral, six postdocs are associated with it, of which I'm one of them. We have a number of events. We've had a number of fun events we've had last year. We had a film season, and we try to do things slightly differently, so you're more than welcome to come along. We have a website, conspiracydemocracy.org, on which you can see also the program for next term, so you're more than welcome to come along to that. And today we are very fortunate and very happy to have Dr. Andy Martin, who's going to be giving us the final talk then of this term. He's a lecturer in French and MML, Modern and Medieval Languages, here. He's recently published a book of which is linked, I think, to the talk tonight, which was entitled The Boxer and the Goalkeeper, Sartre versus Camus, which explores the kind of infamous falling out the two of them had. Although I have to say, if they did come to fisticuffs, my money was on Camus, because Sartre talks about boxing and all that, but I'm not really particularly convinced. Yes, or maybe not.
I could object to that.
Could you?
Well, the thing that Sartre writes about is that he actually took his students to the gym to actually fight in the ring. I think we're not allowed to do that anymore.
Did he get pummeled?
Yeah, he did, in fact, actually. But he took it well. They were all bigger than he was.
Yes, okay, good. So the talk tonight will be on Nausea in New York, the FBI and CIA versus Sartre and Camus. The format. The last thing I wanted to say, Andy, is has another kind of moonshines as either roadie or as part of the band with his sons, who are both musicians. And there's rumors that they may kind of come together again and play some time in hot numbers off No Road. So watch that space.
I wish that were true. Right.
It
doesn't
moonshine.
Moonlight. I like that moonshine. There. It's similar.
Maybe, but
The reality is, that was my serious job. I've been sacked from that one.
Okay. So the format of the talk will be, Andy will speak for 45 minutes, and then conventionally one of the postdocs, I mean, he has to make some kind of intelligent comment. I can't promise you that's going to happen tonight. And then afterwards we'll have open up the discussion for about half an hour, which then will be followed by drinks. I'm ensured that tonight there won't be just wine, there may also be beer, which is very exciting for us, and which you're all welcome to join us. But anyway, I've talked far too much, Andy, over to you.
Thanks again. Thanks a lot. Yeah, thanks Hugo for inviting me. And a word of thanks for the Freedom of Information Act in the States, FOIA, as they say over there. Had a good friend who showed me how to kind of go through the system, and most of this talk is based on the papers that I had to write from the FBI themselves, who sent me this stuff, which is quite helpful, and has done wonders for my reputation in this specific sense. That when they send you papers, photocopies stuff, send it to you in a big, you know, manila envelope. But on the manila envelope, they have stamped in very large letters, just so there's no ambiguity, Federal Bureau of Investigation. And I had a few of these dropping through my letterbox, and the postman eventually started taking note of this. So one day he says to me, "So is Elliot Ness after you or what?" And my answer is, I certainly hope so. Because certainly in the States, it is a badge of honor. If they're not after you, you've got a problem. If you're not actually on their agenda, ringing alarm bells. I actually have a good friend, a historian, who is in the FBI files. And now this is one of the limits that you run into where the files are concerned. And he knew, in part, the Cuba Committee, fair play, and way back when. And so he knew they had the files on him. So he wrote to them saying, "Is it okay if I see my own files?" And they said, "Yeah, no problem." It takes a lot of correspondence, this kind of thing. They said, "No problem, yeah." So he writes back and says, "Oh, could I actually really see them then?" And they said, "Yeah, you could, except that we have this rule about the posthumous release of papers. So that in order to see the files on you, there's no problem with that. You just have to be dead. So as soon as you're dead, we'll send them to you, which I think is their equivalent, you know, their equivalent of saying, okay, we can tell you, but then we have to kill you. It's actually the other way around, though, isn't it? We'll kill you, then we'll tell you. It's not so much fun either way. But anyway, so it is tricky, and there's one specific FBI agent, which I will refer to, that has caused me a certain amount of difficulty as regards the archives. But yeah, so Hoover. That is better. Much prefer the Hollywood version. J. Edgar, yeah, director of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, of course. This specifically is a letter from February the 7th, 1946, written by Hoover to the special agent in charge at the New York Field Office, drawing his attention to one Albert Camus, alias P.F. Chorus, who is reportedly the New York correspondent of Combat. And Hoover complains that, I'm quoting here, this individual has been filing inaccurate reports which are unfavorable to the public interest of this country. And I'm only kind of going to show this to you once, so that's one of the letters that that's taken from, just to show that the letters are real. And I didn't make them up. And according to that letter, Camus has been listed by the Interdepartmental Committee for Accusation of Foreign Publications. I like that accusation. Or even just reading, but accusation, straight off. And the New York Field Division is instructed, I'm quoting again, to conduct a preliminary investigation to ascertain his background, activities, and affiliations in this country. Well, one of Hoover's underlings finally has the courage to correct the chief and tell him that the subject's true name is Albert Camus, not Albert Camus, but allowed that Camus and Chorus, this being a very diplomatic kind of agent, he says, well, Camus and Chorus, clearly aliases that he's cunningly adopted at some time. And when I say Camus, by the way, it is because subsequently, at this period anyway, most Americans pronounce Camus' name as Camus, to rhyme with famous. Well, Hoover is what I will call an informationist. He demands all available information, and he wants it right now. He anticipates the system, therefore, which we now know, courtesy of Edward Snowden, as prison. And whenever I come across that metaphorical construction with the infinitive to hoover up information, I can't help but think of the great J. Edgar himself. But imagine my excitement when I came across another letter, because I've been through loads, some more exciting than others. This one from Hoover, dating from some years later, concerned the activities of Jean-Paul Sartre, which seemed to refer to prison communications. I was blown away by this. But it was a handwritten note. And I realized later it was more like, well, okay, here you go. It's much, so that's the thing that, wow. And I realized it's probably prior communications, which is much less exciting, of course. For a moment there, I thought that prison had predated the internet age, but then, and this is my argument, in some sense it really did. But before I consider the long-running surveillance that the FBI carried out on those two French philosophers, Sartre and Camus, and conversely also consider the philosophy or philosophies of the FBI and the CIA, I want to go back to 1908 and the work, strangely, you may say, of G.K. Chesterton. In his novel, I want to give you a quotation from his novel, which seems to me to kind of hit the nail on the head. This is his one, The Man Who Was Thursday, in which we meet a philosophical policeman who argues the following. The head of one of our departments, one of the most celebrated detectives in Europe, has long been of the opinion that a purely intellectual conspiracy would soon threaten the very existence of civilization. He is certain that the scientific and artistic worlds are silently bound in a crusade against the family and the state. He has therefore formed a special corps of policemen, policemen who are also philosophers. The work of the philosophical policeman is at once bolder and more subtle than that of the ordinary detective. The ordinary detective goes to taverns to arrest thieves. We go to artistic tea parties to detect pessimists. The ordinary detective discovers from a ledger or a diary that a crime has been committed. We discover from a book of sonnets that a crime will be committed. We have to trace the origin of those dreadful thoughts that drive men at last to intellectual fanaticism and intellectual crime. We deny the snobbish English assumption that the uneducated are the dangerous criminals. We say that the most dangerous criminal now is the entirely lawless modern philosophy. Well, when he wrote that, that was fiction. After reading the FBI files, it doesn't seem to me very fictional. One is tempted, of course, hearing that, I think, to think of much later Philip K. Dick's Minority Report and its precogs, pre-crime. But of course, that forensic approach to the philosopher is neither science fiction nor particularly new. The Athenian FBI, after all, kept a very close eye on Socrates, for example. Napoleon, having crowned himself emperor, took a very dim view of the anti-Napoleonic Madame de Stael's essay on German literature, suspecting it was obliquely about him. But clearly the 20th century was the high point of the pre-prismatic approach of the philosophical police. And they were particularly alert to the potential threat posed by French philosophers. Not in a way that I blame them. Looking at it from the FBI point of view, Jean Baudrillard, for one, high priest of postmodernism, actually called himself a philosopher terrorist. Deconstructionists. The name alone should have been enough to set off alarm bells. Does that mean they don't like the Empire State or what? At the very least, they would seem to deserve some fairly close attention by the G-men. But so far as I know, Jean-Paul Sartre was the first French philosopher to come to the attention of the FBI. They basically wanted to know what this new intellectual fanaticism known as existentialism was all about, and whether it amounted to an intellectual crime, and above all, of course, if it was just another name for communism, one of its many fronts or covers. So just to mention the context, the end of the Second World War, the number one enemy on the horizon had swung back away from Nazism to communism. But the Reds were cunning. They typically pose as something else to fly under the radar. Everything, therefore, was potentially a coded, covert rewrite of the Communist Manifesto. That was the sneaky thing about the manifesto. It was not manifest. More often it was, as Freud would say, latent. Thus, FBI agents were forced to become psychoanalysts and hermeneutes, drawn into what the historian Carlo Ginzburg has called, rather neatly, the synergetic paradigm, in which he includes Freud, Sherlock Holmes, and an art historian. So, we find these FBI agents reading scholarly articles and going to lectures, rather like students of French philosophy, in fact. But the FBI were philosophical policemen in a second sense. In tracking philosophers, they inadvertently give expression to their own philosophical investigations. Well, it was Camus, as editor of Combat, the clandestine resistance newspaper, who commissioned Sartre to come to the US in the first place in early 1945, while the war was still going on, as part of a journalistic mission. And so he was part of a team, effectively, Sartre at this point. And they were actually invited by the American government, specifically the Office of War Information, with a view to putting out some positive propaganda messages about the American war effort. And then, and this is how it worked, the FBI panicked after this invitation had gone out, that it actually let in a bunch of cheese-eating surrender monkeys, surrendering, in this case, to the Soviets. Again, I'm not entirely unsympathetic to the FBI. After all, would you employ Jean-Paul Sartre, author of Being and Nothingness and Nausea, and probably the most trenchant philosophical one-line of the 20th century, Hell is Other People, to write propaganda for anyone? Well, oddly enough, someone in the State Department really did think it was a good idea. And it was this guy, Archibald MacLeish, Undersecretary of State Archibald MacLeish. Well, MacLeish is now best known as the author of that classic formulation of the modernist aesthetic taken from one of his poems, Ars Poetica, in fact. A poem should not mean, this is his classic language, and no doubt most of you will recognize, a poem should not mean, but be. Well, MacLeish spent several years in Paris, spent several years in Paris being a poet, in fact, went on to become Librarian of Congress and Professor of Rhetoric at Harvard, but during the war, he worked for Roosevelt's Assistant Director of the Office of War Information. I suspect he was the main inspiration behind Sartre's invitation, and he was a founding figure of the research and analysis branch of the Office of Strategic Services, the precursor, of course, to the CIA. And as I say, he loved Sartre. According to FBI files, it's actually in the files, he asked a journalist not to, I'm quoting now, not to forget to inform Sartre, whose talent he loved so much, that he was rejoicing in advance over his visit. Meanwhile, Sartre, on arriving in New York, this is January 1945, writes, this is the first thing he writes, that he's suffering from le mal de New York. So New York sickness, or as I like to translate it, nausea in New York. Big help in the war effort. Thanks very much, Jean-Paul. You can go away again now. It was too late. He was in. So Hoover and his merry men are soon on the Sartre trail. And it turns out that anyone who was in the resistance is automatically under suspicion of being communist. Meanwhile, there's a US-based French woman journalist, Geneviève Tabouille, who is busily fingering Sartre and his group. And there's a wiretapped conversation in which Tabouille says, can you tell me, and this is with regard to this 10-strong group of journalists, including Sartre, can you tell me off the record if they're all stinkers? She says off the record, it's actually being recorded, of course, but never mind. And one of the guys replies to one of the, this is the group, one of them, de Noyer, who's a correspondent for François, says, they're all communists, except for me. I forget which one de Noyer is. You can recognize Sartre, I think, with the pipe at the front. So meanwhile, Sartre, the great self-confessed writing machine, is churning out articles at rate of knots. And one of his first articles for Le Figaro, back in Paris, denounces French journalists working in the US as anti-resistance, in league with the State Department and sponsored by high finance, leading to this headline. Oh yeah, and this is, by the way, Sartre at the Pentagon. I think this may be the only time that he kind of canoodles with, you know, American generals, but okay, it does happen briefly. Someone sent me that photo, great, I think. But that's the headline in the New York Times. The Gulfos paid by US, Paris is told, i.e. by Sartre writing, sending his articles back, so they're kind of outraged to some extent. And so Sartre is, and this is the point I really want to stress, Sartre is fully conscious from the beginning of being spied on by someone, by many people perhaps, perhaps by everyone to some extent. This accusation, of course, Geneviève Tabouille strenuously denies in the New York Times, even while simultaneously reporting it straight back to the State Department. And here she is, reporting it to the State Department. That is, in fact, Geneviève Tabouille. I assume in the background that's some kind of Russian spy, that, you know, a real Russian spy that actually taking no notice of, distracted by French philosophers, as they are at this point. So in this bipolar world, there's something of a small-scale civil war on the French side being fought out in the US. At the same time, there is equally a conflict within the US itself, even within different elements of the State Department. some pro, some anti-existentialist. Sartre, in the view of the FBI agents who are trailing him, is interpreted as being a very slippery customer who seems to be capable of evading surveillance. So one agent, who's supposed to be keeping a tail on him, follows him to Schenectady, where he's supposed to be, Sartre is supposed to be singing the praises of the General Electric plant. But Sartre, probably out of sheer boredom, I imagine, ducks out and hops on a train, this is quoting the agent, on the afternoon of March the 1st, apparently bound for New York City. In other words, the hapless agent, Special Agent Richard L. Levy, actually loses him. They're so clever, these damn French communists, with all their tricks, learned in the resistance. So as I say, anyone associated with the resistance is seen as in cahoots with the Soviets. So as Sartre and his merry men crisscross the country, they go to Los Angeles, Chicago, Detroit, Wichita, and of course Schenectady. They're suspected of contacts with communist organizations, or more importantly, communist front organizations, because every organization is suspected of being communist, potentially. Notably, in fact, the greatest suspicion is directed towards, I know, the French Research Foundation. I felt rather proud of that, actually. Anything with the word friendship in is deemed very suspicious. So too the word peace. And any organizations that have the words peace and friendship in are immediately outlawed. So this is the context which Hoover actually reaches for a real photograph which he had taken, you know, at the time. I'll move on to that slightly more fun photo, actually, I think. So screenwriters and so on, anyone who worked for Hollywood was a red or lying, according to the files. But what was Sartre's attitude to information? In my view, he becomes, in some sense, like Hoover, another informationist. He is conducting an information war against bourgeois society, which doesn't tell the truth about itself. So he's trying to break down capitalism, as he sees it, by heaving these massive information bombs into it. He values total transparency. Sartre is a prophet of, at one level, celebrity culture, what I would call the inside-outside society, in which nothing is hidden, hence his scorn, for example, for the Freudian unconscious. Think, for instance, of the passage in Being and Nothingness, in which the philosopher himself is looking through someone's keyhole, but then realizes, oh yes, that's very interesting, but then, he realizes, of course, there's someone behind him looking directly at him simultaneously. So the implication of that is if you want transparency, you have to be transparent. You have to enjoy the gaze. Basically roll along with Big Brother, because you too are information. You can be penetrated. In Sartre's case, and this is the thing that strikes me in the way he operates, you don't have to steal anything to hack, because he's always already out there. You can't steal information from him because he's desperate to give it all away. And he actually drops in, and this thing, I was amazed by this, in the very few files that he get out of the CIA. He actually drops in on one OSS agent in March 1945 to have a chat and to put him, you know, because everyone's trying to, the FBI are trying to track him down. He actually walks straight into the CIA office. Here I am. And wants to put him in the picture, quotes about the current situation inside France, talking about General de Gaulle as myth, and basically denying that they're all communists. Well, on March the 25th, 1946, Albert Camus disembarks the SS Oregon in Pier 86 in New York, where he's duly stopped and searched owing to Hoover's stop notice. And he notices that he's the only one to be searched. The immigration officer says, oh yeah, sorry, I had to do it, but I can't tell you why. And Camus comments on this, mysterious, but what should I expect after 5 years of occupation? So he knows he's under suspicion right from the outset, and to some extent thinks, oh, okay, there's a little bit of a kind of Nazi regime here, simultaneously, oh, that seems to be the implication. Or, you know, potentially totalitarian. Well, while Sartre in New York discerns, I'm quoting here, as he roams around New York, supposedly talking about, you know, the war effort, and actually describing, quotes, filmy atmospheres, longitudinally stretched masses with nothing to mark a beginning or end, and, you know, wandering around New York in this kind of existential way, and also forecast the downfall of skyscrapers. Camus, on the other hand, is going around town admiring colors, foodstuffs, smells, taxis, tie shops, ice cream, the orgy of violent lights that is Broadway, a jazz bar in Harlem, and the giant camel advertising icon of an American soldier, his mouth open, puffing out clouds of real smoke. Camus also has this tremendous love affair, which goes on with a woman called Pat Blake, Patricia Blake, who's a graduate of Smith College. One funny thing that she does for him, she wants to buy him a present, and she notices that he's obsessed with death as he roams around New York, as he might well be. So she actually, does anyone know this, she actually buys him a couple of copies of the issue of the trade journals of a couple of undertaker companies, which are known as, and they're known as Casket as one of them, and the other one is Sunnyside. And he really loved those journals, apparently. Anyway, so Sartre and Camus, this is the point I want to make, have characteristically distinct perspectives on the information war. Camus proposes an aesthetics of discretion and privacy, whereas Sartre tends towards a maximization of information. For Camus, there can be such a thing as too much information. In L'Homme Révolté, he favors a philosophy of limits, I'm quoting there. So, and probably recall Barthes' notion of the degree zero in writing associates with Camus. I think you could say that Camus aspires to a degree zero of information. And when he uses that word mysterious, he actually expects there to be a remainder in our knowledge of others, even after analysis and interrogation and examination. There should be mystery for Camus. Whereas for Sartre, literature is or should be realism to the point of obscenity. I want to skip that. Justin O'Brien, Columbia University, professor of French literature, responsible for inviting Camus to speak at a conference. Need I say that all French academics like him were automatically under suspicion, like Archibald MacLeish, who invited Sartre. He was also CIA. He was an ace translator of the journals André Gide, written various other things, which one can find in the library indeed. But he was also chief of the French desk of the Office of Strategic Services, concerned with, quotes, establishing intelligence networks behind German lines in France, even while reading various poets, some of them explicitly communist. Well, we know that the FBI and CIA were at each other's throats from the very beginning. You're probably conscious of the history of that institutional conflict. We know specifically that the FBI and Hoover, who originally wanted to run the whole global intelligence operation, hated the CIA and the OSS. And there's a nice phrase, and actually, oh yeah, okay. It's a nice phrase which I take from Sartre. Well, I say nice, of course, it's entirely rebarbative, a binary practice of antagonistic reciprocity. And precisely because it is so rebarbative, it's actually memorable, I think. And I find that it accounts rather well for the relationship, strangely, if you think of it, of the FBI and the CIA. But what is going on here, philosophically speaking? Oh, I just want to give a picture of that. This is one of the things that the agents have a pinch from someone's bag, passport, and they see, you actually see the hands of the agent who's holding it open while taking photographs of it. So philosophically speaking, what is going on here? Well, the FBI and CIA are philosophical policemen, of course, but also in this neglected second sense that I want to talk about now. Well, no one would try to maintain that Hoover and co. were not deeply suspicious of philosophers, especially foreign ones. They were, in some sense, anti-philosophers or philosophobic. But, and this is, and that's what you expect, but this is what really strikes me, They're not just keeping tabs on philosophers, they have their own kind of philosophy too. In the course of their synergetic activities, they give vent to their own version of being and nothingness. Well, the precursors of the CIA, MacLeish and O'Brien, for example, have a manifest aesthetic or philosophical sensibility. They start off, as I've suggested, as pure modernists in the 20s and 30s, the not mean but be school, but evolve in the course of the war and above all the occupation into sympathizers, fond of solidarity and collective action, those Camusian values that O'Brien salutes. The CIA, in short, have affinities with the foreign, as Justin O'Brien says. And I'll give you a little quotation. He's talking about Gide here, talking about translation. It is much less important to capture the thought than to reproduce the gait. Strange thing to say, unless you think that he's talking about sort of Mission Impossible style approach, that you have to mimic or impersonate the other. And this is what the CIA offers to do. What then of the FBI? And the reason I wanted to focus on that is the letter that's associated with that is the thing they point out is, we can't read the original. One of the agents notes, having stolen a lot of stuff from this bunch of French guys roaming around, what their phrase for stealing stuff is, obtained from the personal effects of someone. They then say, the material is all in French. So they actually have to buy in some translators to work it all out. So they're obviously anti-communist, but perhaps, I would argue, really not quite anti-communist enough in that they never take communism seriously. Communism doesn't really make sense to the FBI. Why? Because nothing does. And I'm indebted for that thought mainly to Agent James E. Tierney of the New York Field Office, who in response to continued pestering from Hoover, what the hell is existentialism all about anyway? Come on, you guys, you haven't given me an answer yet. He finally comes up with several pages drawing on Justin O'Brien, the political philosopher Hannah Arendt, and others. And he's the closest, I believe, the FBI comes to my fantasy of the FBI agent in shades and a sharp suit, poring synergetically over being a nothingness, as I imagine here. He is the ultimate, this is Tierney, closest I can get to a photo of Tierney, the ultimate philosophical policeman. Here he is on Camus, I'm quoting now. This philosophy recommends living with the absurd, enjoying life all the more fully, because it has no meaning. Philosophically speaking, the CIA, I would argue, are Hegelians, heirs to Descartes, who privileged the cogito mind, history as idea. And I'm using Hegel here, by the way, as the preeminent historicist. For them, history has structure, direction, meaning, logic. History has a narrative. The FBI, in contrast, are reluctant Hegelians, neo-existentialists in the classic early Sartrean mold, or absurdists like Camus, who, by the way, was broadly anti-Hegelian too. So they, like Archibald MacLeish, take the view that people, not just poetry, should not mean, but be. They don't like meaning. They're on the lookout for it, especially secret coded meanings, but they don't like it. They certainly subscribe to the hell is other people school of thought. Remember how they hate anything to do with friendship. Hoover in particular would be greatly relieved if only everyone across the whole of the USA was an angst-ridden, anomic, introverted loner. What they fear and object to and fundamentally refuse to respect is, of course, the collective, but more than that, as I've said, meaning, and finally, the plot or narrative. They are anti-narrativists and therefore anti-Hegelians. Or as Agent Tierney would say, quoting, painfully lucid in the face of life's irrationality. Well, I come back here to Sartre's classic modernist critique of narrative in that great early philosophical novel of his, Nausea. All narrative is teleological. secretly has an end or telos in view, whereas life is anti-teleological. There is no meaning, no logic, no structure, no telos. You have to choose, writes Sartre, vivre ou raconter. You can't have both, live or narrate. In life, he says, nothing ever happens. Well, the CIA Hegelians believe in narratives. Hoover's FBI, a quintessential existentialist, in refuting narrative, they choose vivre versus raconter. They would rather have contingency and chaos than telos. Well, Sartre was always grappling with Hegel and is even more Hegelian after the war, more concerned with history. And this is part of the conflict or agon between Sartre and Camus. Sartre shifting from the lost soul existential cowboy towards the more collectivist concept of the group infusion, in which the individual is always up to something, collaborating or cooperating with somebody with some goal in view, is more CIA, as is demonstrated by actually dropping into the office. Camus post-war is more FBI. Look, for example, at L'Homme Révolté, a classic of anti-totalitarianism. The FBI and Camus both hate the group infusion. For them, fragmentation is okay, coherence is bad. The FBI find Camus fundamentally their kind of guy, the Camus of the absurd and the outsider, according to which the individual will never really make sense of the world, nor hook up in any kind of long-term way with others. And I could give you some quotes in which they say, okay, let Camus go, he's okay. So we can see that the existentialist ethic implies an underestimation of kinship ties, as Levi-Strauss would say, or family resemblances, Wittgenstein. Communism, in contrast, could be defined as an overestimation of kinship or empathy. Well, the FBI reading of Sartre, as we would expect, is broadly deconstructive. They conclude, after many years of puzzling over his oeuvre, noting his links with Che, Bertrand Russell, the Black Panthers, and the anti-Vietnam War movement, that, and I'm quoting, it is impossible to know if he is pro-communist or anti-communist. Well, we're apt to think, because they don't forget about Sartre, they kind of forget about Camus, but not Sartre. We're apt to think of the FBI as the great conspiracy theorists, conspiracy hunters. Some level, this is fair comment, I guess. And some of the time, reading the FBI files, it seems as if communists, blacks, gays, Hollywood screenwriters, poets, are all in it together. Oh yes, and the Kennedys, not forgetting them. Oh, and women, yeah, and of course, students, above all, students. Potentially anyone, in short, but especially French philosophers. You know, and if you're a student of French philosophy, okay, you're really doomed. But the reality of the FBI is really quite nuanced. I'm tempted to say that they're not really conspiratorial enough. They resist theory. They don't really want to believe in plots. No plotting, please. We're American. Plotting is some damn foreign import. Okay, who killed President Kennedy? Dallas, 22nd November 1963. You will say, probably not Jean-Paul Sartre. And yet, at some point in those files, the possibility is there of the grassy knoll, the mysterious, shadowy figure. The FBI note that Sartre is a member of the Fair Play for Cuba committee that also involved Oswald, of course, but they refuse to make any connection. Was the assassination of Kennedy a conspiracy? The FBI won't have it. They were, in their typically existentialist way, intent on the Oswald lone wolf story, or non-story. Lee Harvey Oswald, of course, even though a member of the Communist Party who had actually been to Moscow is depicted by the FBI as a man without connections, conflicted, a gnomic, disconnected loner. Whereas what they object to Sartre is that he, quote, promised to take part in the French Who Killed Kennedy Committee, which contended that Oswald was not the assassin. In other words, that he had connections after all. It's being used as some kind of scapegoat or fall guy. So they object to the conspiracy theory, sure. So, of course, when it comes to 9/11, well, they weren't really conspiratorial enough in their thinking. It's not that they have lost the plot. They don't want to know about plots. They are plot skeptics. They underplot. Whereas the whole point of CIA, in contrast, is to come up with plots where none exist. This is the CIA as novelists, spinners of fiction and narratives. Well, summarizing then and coming to a conclusion, narrative philosophy and espionage share a common genesis. They arise out of a lack of information. Sartre's expectation of a world of total information would kill them all stone dead. There would be no more need for the FBI, novelists, or French philosophers, but as Sartre says in one of his resonant phrases, what we have is a detotalized totality. Camus agrees on the impossibility, quotes, for us of grasping the totality, which is why, in the end, there is something of the philosophical policeman in us all. And just in closing, in this spirit, I have one remaining question. Whatever happened to Albert Camus, the original cause of Hoover's anxiety attack? Well, one very bright agent, James M. Underhill, sounds like a character from Tolkien, I think, doesn't it? But anyway, there he is in the files, desperate to find someone actually called Camus, as per Hoover's, well, Hoover said it, I'm doing it, finally tracks Camus down on the 18th of March, 1946. There's no sign of Camus getting off a boat in New York, but digging through the files, Agent Underhill happens upon solid gold. File 7000/1566. Camus, the agent reports, was in fact apprehended by Border Patrol in New Orleans, living in 1622 Jackson Avenue. He claimed to be a mess boy on the SS Mount Everest, which docked in New Orleans, April 24th, 1943. But the ship sailed away again on May the 3rd, and he didn't. So immigration were planning to put him on another ship to get rid of him, but he probably got away, and nobody liked to say so. So nobody really knew what had happened to him. Well, there's a lesson here, partly to do with the determination of agents to do Hoover's bidding, find someone to fit the bill. Also something to do with the meaning, after all, of existentialism. And I was going to say something like, if asked to define, I am not my information. I am not reducible to a collection of data. I am a detotalized totality. But Agent Underhill, surely referring to the classic distinction between narration and experience, puts it so much more neatly, the file does not show the final disposition. I think it's a good point for me to end on. Thank you.
Well, Andy, thank you very much for a very lively and fun chat. Yes, if you want to leave now, because I'm supposed to give a comment. I think it was very nice to bring out the kind of certainly unexplored elements of both French and American history. But I think there's really substantive and interesting points in there too. And what I want to do in my comments is try to bring them up by linking them with some of the kind of the theories we've been talking about trying to deal with within our group. And particularly I wanted to talk about how we might try to distinguish between conspiracy or theories of conspiracies and conspiracy theory in itself. Mm. And in many ways, I'm very struck by, I think, the way that you present the FBI as being very anti-theory and the CIA is kind of very pro-theory in a certain way, right? And that's quite striking. And in a way, I suppose I want to use those two institutions as a way of talking about different ways you can conceptualize theories. And then see if that sounds in any way interesting or if you have anything more to say about that before we open up.
Yeah.
So start with the FBI, and you push very much a line at the FBI. They very much believe this is the kind of the lone gunman theory. It's the of Harvey Oswald. There's another link that you make somewhere else, which I think is quite a fun link. That he looks. You can draw this link between Camus' kind of Merceau that you have in L'Étranger, where it's this, well, Lee argued Horswald is like this Mercer character. He kills this Arab. It's not really sure why. Maybe he's got a bit of a heat wave. Maybe he's, you know, there's something he said to his friend. You know, that's fine. And you can see why they would push that kind of agenda, because it's much easier to say, well, it's just this loony guy who's come in and shot the president. Mm. If it's to do with a broader plot, then there's obviously going to be questions that will be asked as to what the security breaches that might have happened in terms of the FBI. So there's an element of cover-up going in there. And that might be the case, but I wonder whether... Actually, the biggest concern that the FBI probably had is that even though they want people to be all these loners who have no connections with one another, of course, the biggest concern is that if these loners actually do start getting together, and you have different people coming together who then exercise a certain amount of agency, that's when you do start getting plots or conspiracies. It's when people come together. And I wonder then if that's one way we can talk about conspiracies, in the sense that you see the world not in this kind of theoretical way, but you still have conspiracy as one of the prime concepts through which you understand, try and understand politics. That is, your biggest concern is that there are going to be certain communist people or certain people who are against the government. They're going to try to come together and they're going to try to conspire or plot and to try to do something. But within that vision, there's a sense of agency for the respective actors. And also the outcome is very, very open-ended, because there might be lots of different conspiracies going on at the same time. I mean, on the one hand, you would have people like the communists who are plotting perhaps against the government, but then you have people in the FBI who are probably plotting against plotters themselves, and it's not really clear what's going to, the end result is going to be. So that's kind of one way we might think about theorizing conspiracy. The other side then is more the conspiracy theory side, and I think it's very interesting that a lot of people, like the people you mentioned, Archibald MacLeish and Justin O'Brien, were all involved. So Archibald MacLeish then went on to go become professor of rhetoric at Harvard. So Justin O'Brien is professor of French at French in Columbia. These are people who are very...
But simultaneously a spy. At least that's what Columbia University hope is the case, because they're rather proud of that tradition,
okay,
of being simultaneously academics and spies.
And spies.
Oh, yeah.
And they're very, the background are very kind of infused with a lot of French continental philosophy at the time, which at the time, I suppose the best way to characterize that would be something like structuralism, which is kind of Marxism, which comes into structuralism, which sees the world as mainly these main structures, and which is what determines what's actually going to happen. Agency is somewhat underplayed, and you often, with the Marxist line that comes with it, you often get this idea that there's kind of two sides. You're either on one side or the other. You know, if the double Marxism, you're either proletariat or bourgeois.
Yeah.
You have this kind of that follows through in structuralism. So if you're looking at conspiracy from that point of view, of course, what you're going to see is this unitary large actor that's moving through history, and you're either on the good side or the bad side of that. Which is quite a different conception than of how we're approaching conspiracy. So I suppose those are those two conceptions of conspiracies that can lie at the nature. You might want to link up with either the kind of way you've talked about the FBI, one of the ways you talked about the CIA, and I think most interestingly, in the way that depending on what kind of viewpoint you're coming from, you're going to look at conspiracy from a different way. If you're infused with a certain continental philosophy, that's going to make you look at conspiracy in a kind of unitary manner, which is how we conceive of conspiracy theories often today. There's this unitary actor, and the difference here might be, on the one hand, you have the kind of Manchurian candidate account, which is behind the scenes, the Russians are controlling everything, but there's one unitary actor, versus the kind of FBI account, which is, no, there's all these different plots going on at the same time, but actually it's a bit of a mess, and that's kind of the account of politics. But I suppose I just wanted to kind of bring that out in terms of what you're talking, how you can link it with two different theories of conspiracy, which we've been talking about today.
Yeah.
I don't know if you want to say
anything.
Thank
you. Yeah, I think what sprang to my mind, perhaps quite uselessly, what you were speaking about, is that great movie, The Lives of Others, the one about East Germany and the Stasi, and... the agent pursuing a writer over there. And the key thing about that film, I haven't seen it, wonderful film, by the way, is that the agent, having been set up by his equivalent of Hoover to you know, track down, probably find evidence against the writer, actually swings around in the course of the film and becomes sympathetic to the writer and his philosophy to some extent. And the thing that I suppose I take from that, and seems to me that is kind of crucial to grappling with this moment in history, which seems to be a fairly exemplary moment, is that one shouldn't necessarily see, all the philosophy over here and all the Secret Service agents over there and being in some kind of, an antithetical relationship at all, because it is clear, at least by reading the stuff that these agents write, that they are themselves to some extent persuaded or engaging with genuine philosophical issues, so that there is a kind of philosophy of conspiracy or anti-conspiracy, as it may be, that you can actually find in the files of the FBI and the CIA themselves. It's very, very interesting to see what they say about themselves. What you would expect, and you're right, there's a whole kind of philosophical history on the continental side, which tends to get boiled down from the American angle at this point to communism. But you're right, there's kind of, proto-structuralism, and then later on, deconstruction and so on, apart from existentialism, which preoccupies them, well, even now, actually. I can remember being asked to go on some radio program not very long ago in New York City. Can you explain what existentialism is? It's still a kind of mythically impossible to understand concept, apparently, over there. But I guess the thing that strikes me in looking at the philosophy of both the FBI and the CIA and their approach to conspiracy is, of course, that it's full of contradiction, as you would expect, because the FBI are the great conspirators themselves, even though they're hunting down conspiracies and refusing to have anything to do with conspiracy. They are, as it were, the guys who are allowed to conspire against conspiracy, and even while denying the validity of conspiracy in any shape or form. The CIA, on the other hand, or at least the ones that I've been able to look at, buy into the notion of positive conspiracy. There's a kind of a contradiction on the CIA side, which I'm sure you were in concert while I was talking about them being Hegelian, because of course they actually want positive agency. They themselves talk about intervening in, as it were, the plot of history, swerving it around in some way and making their own narrative on top of any existing narrative. So that's kind of curious thing. There was some kind of crucial point that I've now forgotten, actually, but might come back to me in a sec, so I'll just throw that open to there was some crucial thing, but please go ahead. Okay. I'm trying to think of that crucial thing.
Okay. Are there the floor is now open? Are there any questions?
Oh, yeah, okay, I'll tell you what the crucial thing was. Okay, tyranny. What I would like to do, and why I'm stuck, and it's such a small point, is if you're really going to get to grips with, as I think is quite a useful thing to do, as well as theorizing, to actually look at what specific agents are thinking. Because, of course, when one talks about the FBI and the CIA, one is instantly making the mistake of assuming that it's monolithic, which it isn't. Because there are these arguments going on within those organizations as well as between them. And so Tierney was one guy whose philosophy I wanted to try to pin down. So, of course, I wrote to the FBI saying, your man Tierney, could I have some more information about him? And they said, yeah, of course. So I said, okay, yeah. Well, can you send it to me? And they said, yeah, sure. Can you prove that he's dead? And then we can send it to you. And I said, well, look, here's the thing. He's one of your guys. You will know if he's actually dead or not. And they say, yes, but you have to prove it to us. Then we. I just mentioned that in passing, by the way, actually, because it's bugging me. And it's a real issue, but please, Hugo, go on.
Questions?
Yeah.
Can you just say a little bit about the... So it's a rather strange narrative dealing with these guys from the fringes.
Yeah.
But you're viewing it through the lens of these guys now.
Yeah.
So what sort of narrative do you feel those guys have of the guys from the 40s?
Oh, right.
Or don't they have a narrative? Or is there an irony? Or what's actually sitting in there?
Yeah, that is a good point, because undoubtedly... And By the way, in trying to actually get hold of Tierney's original papers, which I only have, you know, the kind of the foam, the froth of at the moment, I'm trying to balance that equation somewhat because, yeah, I'm conscious that I'm coming at this from a very contemporary, but I'm trying to actually at the same time grasp that specific context. And I suppose, you know, I myself am coming from it from a slightly kind of, you know, Derridian, post-Derridian perspective. And I suppose the Derridian perspective here for me effectively is, oh, well, look, apart from the fact that Derrida, of course, is one of those philosophers who, and by the way, no, I haven't got any FBI files on him yet. One of those who, you know, made the trip many times and became Americanized. And in fact, when I knew Derrida way back when, he couldn't speak English very well, but then he had acquired English quite well, having been over to Yale loads of times, and with an American accent, but anyway. So that, you know, cross-Atlantic relationship, which one tends to think, and certainly the way the FBI was setting up in terms of a kind of, you know, binary opposition, one can see as much more of a kind of dialectic in which there are all those kind of interesting philosophical cross currents, you know, on both sides, you know, between Sartre and Camus. So it's not, you know, this is not continental thought, there's actually an argument going on there, and similarly on the American side. So I guess that was the that was probably the, yeah, just thinking of the structuralist thing, you know, I think basically, because I'm a sort of, you know, fellow traveling structuralist, really, by trade, I guess. And therefore, I tend to think, or at least I think this is implicit in structuralism, conspiracies are real. You know, Foucault and so on. In fact, there's nothing but conspiracies. To think there's anything other than a conspiracy is just stupid. It's just, you know, pre-structuralist existential thinking. That, you know, it's just a bunch of solitary individuals all doing their own thing instead of guys who are hooking up, collaborating all the time, whether they know it or not. So I'm very much of that kind of school, I guess, who say, okay, conspiracies are so real, it's actually hard to notice that they're going on and they're sort of everywhere. But at the same time, you know, within that structuralist thing, since if you ask me how I'm kind of coming at it, I'm trying to sort of sympathize with what I think of as the FBI angle on, okay, we've got to track down this guy, we've got to track down that guy, that, you know, a particular individual, as it may be Oswald. So that strange, yeah, notion of the lone wolf, which I guess, yeah, the Meursault, it's absolutely inexplicable why Meursault would do this and so on. I was recently attending a kind of conference in the States, which was mainly to do with thriller writers, in fact, actually. There was one particular thriller writer who was saying, obviously, the idea of Oswald the lone wolf is insane because, you know, no decent professional, like guys in the army and the FBI and the CIA, would attempt to assassinate someone on their own. That's got to be a myth. So he was very much taking the conspiratorial view of, you know, modern history that I suppose is implicit in, yeah, certainly in the thriller novels that he was talking about, actually. But anyway, so that probably influences me as well, actually, setting aside the philosophy. Probably the tradition of the roman noir is, I suspect, is uppermost in my mind when I'm sort of reading some of those files.
John, one intriguing omission is Simone de Beauvoir.
Oh yeah.
But was she in this gang of
she's in
philosophers?
She's in the files.
Right.
Yeah, and yes, I've omitted her because mainly I was focusing on, you know, the two guys, but also she comes in later, so she doesn't turn up in that immediate post-war period.
And she had a relationship with Nelson Albert.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Which was revenge against Sartre, because Sartre, of course, had picked up a girlfriend in New York, who was, in fact, his interpreter because unlike Derrida, he never bothered getting the hang of the English, you know, just relied on having a very good accent, French accent, you know. This other woman, and so, you know, and of course, since he obeys, and the interesting thing beyond the mere gossip column aspect of that is because he, you know, obeys the principle of total transparency, of course, is immediately writing Simone de Beauvoir, oh, I've got this cool, you know, American girlfriend now, actually. And, you know, we're having regular, you know, orgies and so on in New York. It's really cool, you know, you should come get into this. So, yeah, so Simone de Beauvoir, oh, right, yeah, that sounds good. I'll come on over sometime, but, you know, not when you're around. So she does, indeed, yes, has that well-documented affair, which I probably don't want to comment on, but interesting though it is in itself, that the whole Franco-American relationship is to some extent exemplified within that, I think. But I'm just trying to recall the files on Beauvoir. And I think, if I remember, but I'd have to do further research on that, that they don't really pick her up when she's on her own. They only start picking her up when she is with Sartre, which frequently, of course, they were. It's just because his name set alarm bells off, I guess, actually, at that point. So then she was seen as it being in conjunction or in cahoots, basically. So I suppose they were seen as a mini conspiracy in some sense. Sartre and Beauvoir, and then through the kind of Cuban years of Black Panthers and so on, 60s, and yeah, relationship with Che, all of those things did register. But in terms of, you know, did any of the FBI agents actually read the second sex? I'm not sure, and I hope that they did, but that I need to do further research on that.
You keep saying cahoots, sorry, you realize this is from the French.
Oh, right,
it's
yeah.
It's having a gate at the back, you would have in the back, like you have a garden shed.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
You know, and men would go there and they would
conspire. Yeah, yeah.
Obviously,
it's
the women.
You know, I've never seen that derivation. I can see
I
that.
Think
yeah,
so.
Of course, the French would claim some priority in that, no doubt, actually.
Like yourself. Alfred.
I just wanted to ask you to say a bit more. You talk about Sartre having this kind of sort of philosophy of transparency, of you know, letting it all hang out, hiding nothing, displaying everything. And Camus, by contrast, being this philosopher who talks about discretion, the inescapability, the unknowability of yourself, the need for privacy. Yet it's Sartre who comes under greater suspicion, and they start, you know, and the CIA start ignoring Camus.
Yeah.
Are those two things connected in any way, or is that purely coincidental? And further, is their respective kind of attitude to transparency and openness as a personal virtue, is that something that these agents pick up on? Is that something that concerns, or is that, again, something...
It's a really good point that I don't think I've really properly addressed, because I find it's kind of ironic to start off with, that the FBI pursuing Sartre, just like lines of others, Stasi got, start becoming existentialist and or sympathizing, certainly with some of the propositions of broadly under the heading of existentialism. But it's true that insofar as Sartre is seen as much more suspicious, and you know, we instantly say, oh, it's because he's got, you know, he's more in cahoots with the communists than Camus is, quite obviously. It may well be that part of the anxiety about Sartre is the notion of transparency, because part of the FBI raison d'etre, of course, is that there's not enough information out there, that we are the ones who control the flow, we have possession. And they're very proprietorial about the information, which is partly why there's this incredible institutional conflict going on to our day, to this day, as we know, with Obama and the relationship between CIA. Hey, can't you guys get together, you know, whatever it was Obama said. Can't you learn to cooperate with something like this? So I wonder if that could be... part of their anxiety then. In other words, the theory, which for Sartre, it is a kind of utopia in some sense, of the notion of maximum information, in which, by the way, you don't have literature anymore, because he's really sick of literature, and specifically of Camus, who seems to exemplify it by this point, even though he isn't such a writer. That is actually a, you know, something they kind of share in common there, that or rather that is the ultimate fear of the FBI then, that all of that information would become available, and therefore they have no justification of existence in, you know, hunting down secret sources of information. Yeah, I quite like that. That's very plausible, I think, actually. Rather than Camus. And they say, okay, he can go away. Yeah, with his theory of privacy and secrecy and mystery. Yeah, no, that is great. Hey, look, everything, yeah. No, it's bizarre. Hey, we can't, it's like, okay, everything you want to know, okay, it's here. It's right there. Everything's right out there. But they don't trust that. The guy who's saying, okay, here's everything about me. Yeah, okay, keep an eye on that guy. No one can really believe that. Yeah, this one of the great islands. You're right.
Any last questions?
I've sold you beer now, you just already know. Is that it? Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Well, I think we should thank again.